Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
This, the 248th edition of Cut the Clutter, is actually unusual in more ways than one. First of all, I start this actually by cluttering your mind a bit further instead of decluttering. And how do I do that? By mentioning to you the name of Biothil Muhyiddin Kutty. Now, you might feel cluttered thinking, who is this person? And why am I mentioning his name right now? Next, I will tell you that this episode of Cut the Clutter is built around this incredible man who just died at the age of 89. And you know what? He wasn't even Indian. He was Pakistani. Some of you might have seen a tiny news item here and there, but mostly it's been missed by readers and viewers in India, because he's not somebody who mattered so much right now to most people here. Now, why do we talk about him today? And what am I trying to declutter by talking about BM Kutty, as he was popularly known? Through his life, we can throw light on some complications of the partition. We can throw light on the Baloch problem or the Baloch insurgency in Pakistan. We can also talk about the history of the left in Pakistan and the subcontinent. Because you know what? There is no corner in the world, they say, where there is no Malayali. So he was one of those rare, not many Malayalis in Pakistan who went to Pakistan after partition. He was born in Malappuram in Kerala in 1930. But he stayed on, and then he became in many ways probably the most prominent Malayali in Pakistan. Again, wherever you have a Malayali, there will be communism. Doesn't that sound quite reasonable? I think the last place where the left will survive in the whole world will be Kerala, because it seems to be dying even in West Bengal, in Tripura, in India. So BM Kutty left India. He was a trade union activist and a corporate employee. He left India, took the train to Jodhpur, then to Munabao on the border of Sindh, and then walked and hitchhiked from there to get to Karachi and became a Pakistani. He then joined the Communist Party. And you remember, some time back, we had talked about how in 1953, Jawaharlal Nehru put Sheikh Abdullah under arrest because he had got wind of the fact that Pakistan was now becoming a member of the American-led security alliance against communist states or against communism. So in 1954, Pakistan signed those alliances with the Americans, Baghdad Pact, etc. 1954 is the year also when Pakistan banned the Communist Party in that country. So now BM Kutty, the great Malayali, young Malayali from Malappuram, also became a kind of a revolutionary and started some work, not exactly underground, but his party was banned. He never ceased to be a communist. I am now leapfrogging several decades. In 1973, February, Bhutto had just taken over after Shimla Agreement, etc. In 1973, there was a great deal of suspicion in Pakistan that India and the Soviet Union, which were then allies, which had also signed a treaty of peace, friendship and cooperation, really a strategic treaty, were still conspiring to break up Pakistan. That was the fear in Pakistan. There was paranoia. They had just been broken up after all. Bangladesh had gone away from them. So in that process, in February 10, 1973, Pakistan's security forces raided the Iraqi embassy in Pakistan. Iraqi embassy. And remember, that was a time when Iraq was also part of the Soviet Communist Alliance. Why? Because the Pakistani intelligence then thought that Iraqis were fronting for India and the Soviet Union and bringing in arms and explosives for Baloch nationalists. Baloch insurgency was then building up, and Baloch insurgency had a very strong left ideological streak at that point. So Iraqi embassy was raided. More than 300 AK-47s or some AK series rifles were recovered. Iraqis said, you can't touch us, we are diplomats. They couldn't, so obviously Pakistanis couldn't. But through that, they blamed some Baloch nationalists for having been in cahoots with the Iraqis and by implication, India and Soviets. BM Kutty was then a kind of political secretary to Mir Ghaus Bakhsh Bizenjo, a very respectable man. I will tell you about him a little bit more a little later. He was the governor of Balochistan at that point and has been widely hailed as Baba Balochistan, the father of Balochistan. He was a Baloch nationalist, not really a separatist ever in the classical sense. There were times he might have been angry, but he was really somebody who, I think, more longer than for the period where he was a Baloch nationalist, he was still a Pakistani nationalist as well. So he was Baba Balochistan. He was governor. His secretary, BM Kutty, was immediately put under arrest on charge of treason and spying. Why? Simple reason. He was a Malayali. He was not a Punjabi. He was not a UPwala, Bihari, Gujarati. He was not the usual Muhajir or the usual Punjabi who opted for India over Pakistan. He was a Malayali, and that too a Malayali communist. So why the hell did he come to Pakistan? So there was suspicion that he had always been sent by Indian intelligence as their man. So he was arrested, put in solitary confinement, tortured for a long time. And immediately afterwards, a week later, the Balochistan government of Ghaus Bakhsh Bizenjo was dismissed. And Bizenjo also was put under arrest. Bizenjo and many other respected Baloch leaders and Baloch sardars, because Baloches are very tribal, and tribal heads usually have a lot of power. So many of those sardars were also arrested and put through torture and third degree, etc., etc. And then something interesting happened. While this persecution was going on, Kutty's daughter was dropped from her college. She was studying in a medical college and she was dropped. She dropped as in she was dismissed or expelled from there. Her name was Yasmin Mohinuddin. She was studying in Bulan Medical College in Balochistan. That angered Kutty so much. So much. Can you imagine a man in solitary confinement, torture, called a traitor, called a foreign spy? He wrote a very angry letter to Bhutto, saying, how dare you do this to my daughter? And that letter somehow moved Bhutto. Now, this is a story that's been written about many times in Pakistan. Kutty was a very literate person, a man of letters. He also wrote his autobiography, 60 Years in Self-Exile. Self-exile means self-exile from India, from Kerala into Pakistan. That book came out, that autobiography came out in 2011. So Bhutto said that, look, why did you come to Pakistan? Bhutto actually sent for him and gave him an audience. He was so moved by that letter. And Bhutto said, why did you come to Pakistan? You are a Malayali, you are from Kerala, you are a communist. Why did you come to Pakistan? And because you came to Pakistan, in spite of all this, you are suspected to be an Indian spy. So anyway, I think they found a way around it. Ultimately, everybody got out of jail. Bizenjo again joined mainstream politics and Kutty continued to be his political secretary. Then I am again jumping a decade and a half, or just over a decade. 1985, I made my first visit as a reporter to Pakistan. And those were much better days, much more relaxed days in India-Pakistan relations. So relaxed that you could go and meet Sindhi nationalists, you could go and meet Baloch nationalists, just like that, just by renting a taxi. Not even that. Our Consul General in Karachi then, G. Partha Sarthi, who you see very often is a very popular talking head on our TV channels. G. Partha Sarthi was our Consul General. He could drive you himself without a driver or a guard to a food street late at night on the beach in Karachi to feed you kebabs. It was a very relaxed time. So that is when, among the various people I went to meet, was Ghaus Bakhsh Bizenjo. Because now many of these liberal or left leaders in Pakistan primarily, but also many others, had set up a movement called MRD, Movement for Restoration of Democracy. And Bizenjo was one of the key players in it. He was so widely respected, his voice was taken very seriously. And when I went to see Bizenjo, Bizenjo said to me, "Are bhai Kutty?" And suddenly, We were alerted that what is the Kutty doing in Karachi? So he said, "Arey Kutty, ye India se aaye hain Safi. Safi means journalist. Ye kabhi ye na soche ki hamare Karachi mein dosa aur bada nahi milta hai. To inko tum khila ke lao." So Kutty Saab, being Kutty Saab, and we discovered he was a Malayali, he took us to a tiny dosa idli joint in Karachi as well. So it was that kind of a character. After that, in the course of time, in 1989, Bizenjo Saab passed away. Kutty then became a full-time peace activist. He aligned with Nirmala Deshpande. In India, he worked towards India-Pakistan peace. He also worked towards labor issues, towards keeping some left ideological activity alive in Pakistan. Remember, in a country where Communist Party was banned in 1954. And his stature rose so much that while Bhutto had put him in jail as an Indian spy and traitor, and tortured him and put him to third degree and put him in solitary confinement with rats, now Bhutto's daughter and Bhutto's son-in-law repeatedly asked him to come and join their cabinet, which he did not do. His one dream now was peace with India. Once again, he was not a Baloch separatist. He worked all his life with Ghaus Bakhsh Bizenjo. Now, I will use this also to take you a little bit towards Balochistan. Now, Bizenjo was among the early Baloch leaders and sardars who thought that nationalism, separatism, and armed insurgency was a solution. But he was among the first who gave it up. And I do remember in that 85 meeting, that is when Zia had just removed, held a party-less quote-unquote election and installed Muhammad Khan Junejo as the prime minister. But Movement of Restoration of Democracy was still fighting for full democracy. So there is a quote from Bizenjo, which I found in my 1985 story from the file from the archives of India Today, and you will see it behind me. It said, "In Pakistan, the forum for democratic revival has always been on the streets," he said. "But if democratic means fail, there is a real danger of Pakistan breaking apart." Very prophetic words. Now, Balochistan in Pakistan is again having problems. This latest round of insurgencies began in 2013. As I said, there are Sardars and tribes, so they are Bukhtis, they are Mengals, they are Maris. This round of insurgency is primarily led by the Bukhtis. The Sardar of the Bukhtis, Sardar Akbar Bukhti, is somebody I knew well. Knew well means I met him a couple of times, and once jokingly he asked me, "Why did you come to Balochistan? Come to Quetta, it's a beautiful place." And I said, "Sir, we Indian journalists don't get visa to come to Balochistan." He says, "Don't worry, you come to Balochistan, we'll not ask you whether you have the visa or not." He was the governor of Balochistan, who then Musharraf had assassinated using an anti-tank missile while he was hiding in a cave. His son now lives, his children, his family members live around the world, and they are running the current Baloch insurgency. So Bizenjo's words have proven prophetic. Because democratic methods have failed, you again have trouble there. And once again, since we talked about Balochistan, I will tell you just a little insight into Balochistan. It is a very large territory. It is nearly 3 lakh 50,000 square kilometers. The Punjab in Pakistan is about 2 lakh 5,000 square kilometers. So it's more than one and a half times of Punjab. Yet Balochistan has only 5% of Pakistan's population. Punjab has more than 60% of Pakistan's population. But Balochistan's population density is about 36 per square kilometers. Punjab is about 600, maybe even more if you look at the latest census and make those calculations. So it's a very far out part of Pakistan. Lots of mineral wealth, lots of tribes, about 56% Baloch, 36% Pakhtun. It's a very complicated place. And there are about a couple of lakh Baloches, couple of million Baloches in Iran as well. So it's a very complicated situation, and that has been left unfinished. Also, the current Baloch movement does not particularly have a left streak. It is a tribal movement. Now, we are talking about Pakistan's left, and since I talked about people like Khair Bakhsh Mari, Ataullah Mengal, Ghaus Bakhsh Bizenjo, and of course BM Kutty, who were incarcerated early on in the 70s. They were not incarcerated only because they were Baloches, but also because they were communists. And among them was also this incredible Pakistani poet called Habib Jalib. He was Pakistan's permanent poet of dissent. I had the pleasure of knowing him, and he will tell you, ye Zia ke kono ke nishan hai, ye Bhutto ke kono ke nishan hai, because he had been flogged by everybody. And I do remember, he spent time in jail with all of them, and torture, third degree, everything. In the summer of 1990, on May Day, I happened to be in Pakistan. And that is when, once again, India and Pakistan seemed close to war. And Benazir had said, "Hum Jagmohan ko jag jag mo mo han han kar denge." So May 1 in Pakistan, for the first time, I'm not particularly a leftist. I don't think anybody would describe, anybody who knows me, my writings and what I, my views would call me a leftist or a communist. So the only time I attended a May Day rally was actually in Lahore, when Habib Jalib said, "Come to Pakti House," the famous institution of Lahore, like the Indian coffee house maybe in Calcutta, for a Kalam Mazdoor rally, saying that we who live by the pen are also Mazdoors, we are also labor, to a Kalam Mazdoor rally. So I did go to a May Day rally, and Habib Jalib then read his two lines that he wrote at that point immediately, because once again the Kashmir clamor was on. And he said, "Sunehri Zulfon, Nashili Aankhon ke Desh ko Khokar." Aap samajh gaye na? "Sunehri Zulfon, Nashili Aankhon ke Desh ko Khokar." That is Bangladesh. "Main hairan hoon, wo zikr wadiye Kashmir karte hain." That you've lost half your country is Bangladesh, and you are even now going on and on madly trying to get the valley of Kashmir. Can you imagine a man in the summer of 1990 standing in the heart of Lahore and saying this? So Habib Jalib represents also this community, of which I would say BM Kutty was the last surviving member. So in his death, we get an opportunity to talk about many, many different things. An eventful life, very well lived. I only wish he was better known in his country. I know the Malayalam press has covered his death quite extensively, but most of the mainstream media has forgotten him. That's the reason I thought I will take a break from all the other politics in India and tell you a little bit about BM Kutty.